get applause at the beginning, I guess. Some of you must be new to simple notes. Actually, I'd like to take this moment to just remind everybody, on Friday night we had some unauthorized accompaniments, so if you can all turn off your cell phones, that would be great. Thanks. Come on out, John. John? Byron? And we are live streaming on the internet today for the first time. That's kind of exciting. Hi, everybody.
Thank you.
was Tchaikovsky, well, it was Pezza Capriccioso, which means capricious piece by Tchaikovsky. And what was the story of it?
Well, I think there's a little bit of controversy because some people think it is quite a capricious piece, a playful piece. And others think that it's just capricious and that it changes the theme. There's sort of variations on this melody. Sometimes it's basically it's triumphant, maestoso, and then there's these pangs of pain followed with this lightness, this sort of pastoral kind of gesture. So, yeah, and I think that's what I would go with. Basically, he wrote it for a friend in Paris, a cellist, and basically he was, at the time, he was actually taking care of a dying friend, and this was sort of a respite for him to go to Paris and play this showpiece. So, hope you enjoyed that.
Yeah. All right, so hi everyone, thanks for coming tonight. I see a lot of familiar faces out there. How many people, is this their first time at Simple Measures? Quite a few, almost half, that's great. We do things a little bit differently from your traditional classical music concert around here, in that, of course, a lot of people talk to their audiences these days, but we give you the opportunity to talk to us as well. So if anyone has any questions, I will be fielding questions. I see we have one already, so let's start right in, yes. How old was Tchaikovsky? John, do you know how old Tchaikovsky was?
It was
fairly late, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was a later work.
Yeah, so he was, okay. Yeah, he was probably in his 50s.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anything else? Okay. Yeah, I'll give other opportunities, and feel free to just raise your hands, and maybe not while we're playing, but in between, you certainly can. The theme for the next few pieces that we're going to do, the rest of the first half, in fact, is music that was inspired by religious themes. And so the main thing is, there are two things that we're going to be talking about. One is plain song or Gregorian chant, and the other one is chorales. So I'll explain just a little bit what that means. So way back in like the 600s, there was Pope Gregory, and he was the Pope, but he was also a fine musician. And he actually cataloged and created all these chants that we call them Gregorian chants after him, or we also call them plain song. And they became the staple of the liturgical chanting in the Catholic Church for centuries. And in fact, they're still in the Catholic Church, so they're still continuing to be done to this day. That formed the basis of the development of Western classical music, which developed in a way that's unlike any other world music. All the other musics of the world basically consist of melody and rhythm, and they generally don't have multiple voices going on simultaneously. And so it's strange that the Western classical tradition developed the way it did. So we're going to show you a little bit of that progression tonight. I'm starting off with a piece that was written in the late part of the 15th century by a man named Josquin des Prez, and he's generally known as Josquin, just his first name. He was Flemish-French mix, and he was generally considered to be the greatest composer of that era. A lot of people passed the work off as being by Josquin because they would get better sales that way, because he was well known. Yes,
I just realized, since this is a focus on cellos, I don't know that much about cellos. Are all cellos the same in terms of size, shape, and tuning?
So he's asking if, since this is focus on cellos, if all cellos are the same in terms of size, shape, and tuning. Yeah. The answer is essentially the same, although they do vary in size a little bit. I happen to have a cello that's a little on the small side, and some people have cellos that are a little on the big side, and they do actually make cases that are slightly different.
The reason I asked that was because I noticed that when you play, you could almost have your eyes closed. You know exactly where your hand ought to be. Now, if you picked up somebody else's cello, would you know exactly where to put it on?
So the question is, would we know how to put your fingers on another cello? Would you like to feel that, Sean?
Well, actually, it works pretty well on most instruments, except for Rajan's. This is too expensive.
It's actually true. My cello is particularly small, and I have a short string length, so I can't actually play in tune on any other cello. it's an issue. So I just play on mine. I like my cello. Okay, so back to Josquin. So what we're going to play today is probably his most famous work. And it was not, in fact, written for four cellos because the cello had not yet developed as an instrument. It was written for four voices. So we have the soprano, the alto, the tenor, and the bass. And you'll see that it's almost like two separate things going on. The soprano and the alto play a lot together, and the tenor and the bass play a lot together. And so Joy and I sort of trade off the melody. It's a wonderful work. It definitely would be on the greatest hits of the 15th century CD. No question about it. So the thing I want you to particularly listen to is the imitative counterpoint. Counterpoint means two lines, separate lines going on at the same time. Imitative counterpoint is kind of a really fancy way of saying a round. So there's a lot of stuff you'll hear where one voice enters and then the next voice enters with the same music. Especially a dialogue between the soprano and the tenor. So actually, I'm going to get my cello so we can demonstrate that. Hang on. It starts out that way, and this piece is also really well known for having excellent word painting. Unfortunately, we're not going to be singing the words, but but it does. It was a sort of seminal work in its ability to bring across the words very beautifully. It is an Ave Maria, so you can imagine the words, Grazia plena, and it's a fairly familiar verse. At the end, there's something interesting that happens. The last word is, of course, guess what the last word is? Can anyone guess? Amen, that's it. And so we play an open fifth when we do that, and that was considered to be the most pure chord. It's called a perfect fifth because it has no inner vibrations. Can you do that little demo where you play? She's going to play a third first. And it's going, you can kind of hear inner vibrations. Now play an open fifth. And it's very pure and open. Yeah. And so at the end, you'll hear it has this sort of otherworldly quality when we finish that. So, Josquin des Prez, Ave Maria.
Thank you.
very few. Most everybody's heard that, yeah. So of course it's for a chorus, but the cello happens to be the instrument of all the instruments that's most like the human voice. That's one of the reasons that cello is absolutely, unquestionably the best instrument there is. was that funny? So it is very pleasing to hear because it has that human quality to it. And so this was not actually arranged. We were just playing the piece just like a chorus would sing it, because we have the range. We can go as low as the voice goes and as high, or actually even higher than the voice goes. So now we move on to J.S. Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach. We will play one of his chorales. Now, Bach was a Kapellmeister. He was a church musician. He played the organ primarily and was considered the greatest improviser of his day. But he also had to compose like crazy in between raising his 20 children. And so he had to write an entire cantata every week. Can you imagine going to Bach's church and hearing a brand new piece that Bach wrote every single week? Wow. And cantatas are not just little pieces of music. They are masses. In other words, they follow the liturgy of the mass. And so he wrote, there were chorales, which were sort of hymn tunes, and then there were arias, and they were long. They were probably half hour or more each, and interspersed. They would be interspersed in the mass. So, you know, you would have the service, and in between there'd be this amazing music by Bach. Oh, I wish I was there. So anyway, what he did is he took this same idea of plain song, which by the time it developed to Bach's time, the plain song had become these chorales. So that means four-part harmony, and the top part is the Gregorian chant or the melody. And it's like our hymn books, you know, if anyone goes to church or went to church, you have hymn books, and it's the same kind of thing, except that Bach's accompaniments to the melody on top were truly revolutionary. He did all kinds of things that nobody had done before, introducing different notes, unusual notes, and he really pushed harmony in a very different direction with his genius. And so let's get a little sample, just so you hear. All of the other parts, these three parts, are going to be very active, playing lots of different notes and lots of different harmonies. But the top voice is just a hymn tune. Can you play that for us, Troy? All right, and so she goes on that whole time just playing. She has the easy part. Well, it is up high. And this is actually a Kyrie. So Kyrie is a quite a well-known portion of the Mass. Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison. So that first thing was Kyrie. Anyway, sometimes you'll hear us stop and play those three notes. That's generally Kyrie or one of those parts of the Mass. So the thing to listen for here, of course, is the hymn tune on top, and then how complex and interesting his harmonies are, much more so than anyone who came before. And I must say, people have studied Bach. They continue to study Bach all through the ages. They've studied Bach and looked at what he did and figured it out and copied it. And you'll hear some of that copying in the pieces we play later. So, the Kyrie Gott Vater in Ewigkeit, which means God the Father in Eternity, by J.S. Bach.
Thank you.
So we started out with some of the most beautiful choral music composed through the centuries. Wasn't that beautiful? Does anyone have any questions about what we just played? All right. So we're going to move on now to David Popper. David Popper was a cellist, considered to be the greatest cellist, one of the greatest cellists of the 19th century. So we're leaping ahead another 150 years now. And so music has undergone quite a change at this point from that sort of homogeneous sound to much more of a melody and accompaniment. So that whole concept of melody and accompaniment comes out of the chorale idea, where you had that joy playing the melody and everybody else playing this very complex accompaniment, essentially. Except it's very much all parts are kind of moving independently. And then when you get into romantic music, it made a switch over. It actually made the switch in just after the Baroque period, in the classical period, to playing a melody and having accompaniment. For instance, Mozart, if you listen to a Mozart melody, da di di da di dum, and on the bottom is da di di da 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 da, just a chordal accompaniment. So in the piece we're going to play now, it's interesting that, okay, first of all, this was actually written for three cellos and piano, so he was a cellist, so he got it. The cellos all have equal parts, but each one is given a little feature of the melody, and then the piano is featured too. So this is really an equal partnership for everyone. This is a requiem. It's called the Popper Requiem, and it was written for a friend of his who had just died. And that's one interesting thing to note. Close to the end, he does actually have a little chorale in there, because I think chorales have come to denote sort of a religious, it makes you think back to church and religion, and so clearly with the Requiem he was imagining, you know, what happens after death and the kind of things that we all think about from time to time, and so he actually does that chorale close to the end, and you'll hear that the texture completely changes and all three cellos play together in a texture that sounds much more sort of church-like, if you will, and it happens relatively close to the end. In the meantime, it's a very beautiful piece, so just enjoy the Requiem by Popper.
Thank you.
So, beautiful piece, as I said. Does anyone want to share any imagery that came to them while they were listening to that or anything like that? Yes.
I noticed you moved the mutes up for the choral part there.
Uh-huh, yeah. So
and
we
it
put
changed the tonality quite a bit.
Yes.
Harmonics.
Right, so he was saying we put the mutes on for the chorale part, which gave a very different color. To me, it feels sort of otherworldly at that point, you know? It's just a sort of echo of perhaps of heaven or something like that. Of course, you can, that's why I asked if anyone had any imagery that everybody will get their own thing from it. It doesn't necessarily have to make one think of a requiem in particular. So, any other questions? Yes. That's true. So she said there was a little figuration that sounds a lot like the famous Schubert Ave Maria. And I hadn't thought of it that way, but you're absolutely right. It does really sound like that. The main theme is very Ave Maria. Like, thank you for bringing everything all into a full circle for us. Anything else? It's a quiet audience today. That's okay. Yes.
One of the most beautiful pieces I've heard in all the years I've been coming.
That's because it's three cellos.
Yes, exactly. Absolutely. It was beautiful. Right.
Thank you. All right, so now we have a special treat for you. You're going to hear a piece that I would say has never been heard, except we did play it on Friday, but this is the world premiere weekend for this piece. It's brand new. I commissioned it for this concert, and by the wonderful composer Angelique Poteat. And actually, I'll go ahead and ask her. Whoops, it looks like they're talking right now. Okay, I'll vamp till ready. So, this can you come up now? Yeah, here comes Angelique. Angelique Poteat, ladies and gentlemen. Angelique is a clarinetist by trade and composer. Or is it composer and clarinetist? I'm not sure. Kind of equal?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, anyway, she was called at the last minute. She found out a few days ago that she had to play the Mozart clarinet concerto last night with the Yakima Symphonies.
The
last
day's notice. Yeah.
So she has a busy weekend this weekend. At least you don't have to play this piece. You just get to listen. So, when I commissioned this piece, I gave her certain parameters. That's how commissions generally work. You say, well, I want this piece, and I want it to be, well, I said, four cellos. Well, I actually gave you a couple of options for instrumentation. I told you all the instruments we had available and said, knock yourself out. And she chose cello quartet because she's really smart. And so, the parameters I gave her, I told her about the sort of religious sort of chorale theme. And I said it, you know, a certain length and that kind of thing. And then she came up with a piece that fits into this program so beautifully, I couldn't have possibly, you know, dreamed of it being any better. So why don't you tell us a little bit about your piece?
So I was asked to write this piece, and I got the spiritual theme. And the timing of this, when I was asked to write this, was about 2 weeks after my dad had passed away last March. So when I was asked to write it, I wanted to write something anyway for him, because I felt very strongly about it. And when I think about my dad, he's had a much larger influence on my music than I would have thought that he had, and so anyway, I wanted to write something that was meaningful, based on his taste in music and based on my feelings about him. He went very suddenly, and so what I ended up doing is I chose as the foundation for the piece the plain song, In Paradisum, which was one of the pieces that was sung at his funeral. And so I would like to read the English translation of that now. May the angels lead you into paradise, and the martyrs receive you in your coming, and guide you to the holy city, Jerusalem. May the choirs of angels receive you, and with Lazarus, who once was poor, may you have eternal rest. So this is structurally the foundation of this whole piece. I'm basically following the text for this song. And so there are a few things that show up in the piece. This actually uses the musical material from this plain song in Paradisum. So Brian, if I could actually have you play the first couple measures when you come in. This is the switch spots here. This is the opening of the chant. And I'll stop in there because now we go into things that I've added after that. So this is this shows up all over the piece, and the actual text that's happening in that piece or in that segment in Paradisum, may the angels receive you. So that's the paradise theme, and I have a few other themes. I have an angel theme, just kind of a spelling trick. So the angel theme, so that comes out in the piece a lot. Another theme that shows up, I've got a Jerusalem theme. I should say that the large influence that my dad had on me musically, my dad was a huge fan of progressive rock. So, as I'm writing this and I'm transitioning my way into Jerusalem, all I can think about is Emerson, Lake, and Palmer, Jerusalem. And so if you're expecting to hear something like Popper's Requiem, you're not going to get it for this piece. So it's kind of, I don't know, it has its chorale moments. There's a chorale about two-thirds of the way through the piece. And then it has moments that are very much like Led Zeppelin, and throw in your rock band, and so it's a collection of different things that that kind of encompass my dad. So.
Thanks, Angelique. We're actually going to walk you through a couple of those sections so that you can relate to what you're hearing from what's actually going on up here. So I think we won't play the opening. The opening has this active at the bottom, and then Brian comes in with that In Paradisum theme. And then the second section is we go right into what she was referring to with the rock. And you'll hear the first and third cello playing a variation on that same In Paradisum theme. And in the meantime, I am playing a sort of slap bass kind of bass line that really kind of rocks out. And let's actually play a little sample of that right at B.
She's the angel, right?
So you can hear that great riff that I get to play a riff. That's not the only riff. I have a riff later too. Very riffy kind of piece. And then we have the martyr, and John gets to play the is that the right word?
Yes.
Yeah, the martyr. Yeah.
And
Angelique said, as raunchy as possible, right? The
And then we have a section where again we hear that theme over there with Brian, and there's a sort of very ethereal accompaniment going on. And then we get into another section that starts that hard driving rock, and John has the bass going, dee-dong. Can you play that bass after E? No, after E, like where you start the quarter notes? Right. And at that time, I'm riffing again. The idea is to think of a guitar with the distortion pedal on, right? And so when we get to that part, when you think,
I forgot to mention the drummer.
The drummer.
I should get the chopsticks.
Oh.
Oh, save it, okay.
Yeah, we're going to save some stuff, okay. And then we have a transition into Paradise, and so we'll go ahead and give you a little sample of Paradise. And this is what she was referring to as the chorale section, and you'll hear it's very, very homogenous, like it was in the popper, but with very different harmonies than the popper. Hear da dee da 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 over there in the, and that's all. Then it comes to a close, bringing back some of the fluttery angel music from the beginning. So without further ado, and I will take a moment after we play the piece for questions if you may have any. Thank you. questions or comments? Questions for Angelique or anything? Yes.
So that was extremely moving.
That was extremely moving, he says. Thank you, thank you.
Thank you for her. It seemed a little bit like a soul has definitely left the earth and caught images of rocket ships going.
Like a soul has left the earth and images of rocket ships going.
Yeah, I get away and then passing through the asteroid.
Jefferson Airplane, maybe. Was that a question? No.
Yeah,
that
I didn't have a sense of landing.
Of it landing, yes, because it's going on, we would hope, right? Interesting. Yes, over here.
I would be curious to know, both from the composer and from the musicians, how long did this work take you once it came into your hands?
Well, how long did it take you to write this? She was asking how long it took us to put it together once it came into our hands, and it might be interesting first to ask how long it took for you to actually write the piece. Yeah, sure.
Well, I guess it was a process of a few stages, so just brainstorming, thinking about it, thinking about my dad. So I guess I started the whole brainstorming process the middle of March, and I finished the piece. I turned it in the very beginning of September, so just kind of working off and on between then.
And as far as how long it took us to put it together, I'm afraid that's classified. I will actually tell you, we rehearsed this for about 4 hours last Saturday, and then we played through it again a little bit on Tuesday, and then we had a pretty significant rehearsal Friday during the dress rehearsal. So basically two and a half rehearsals, and then Friday was actually our dress rehearsal because it was much more sort of coherent tonight, right? It's always, when you have a brand new piece, it's always, you know, it takes a little bit of settling in, and I think today, for the first time, I personally really felt like I could rest into it and really make some of the things come out that we're supposed to. So, so it's always the second performance, and a nice job coming to the second. Yes.
I noticed it used a lot of harmonics.
Yes.
Strings.
Yes.
Sort of.
So harmonics are where we touch the string lightly. He's asking about the harmonics. We touch lightly and slide along. I think, you know, for me, that has a very sort of ethereal quality.
Ethereal
to it.
Quality.
Yeah. Did you have, was that?
That's what I was thinking, exactly. Yeah.
Yes.
I think the use of the practice mute, the really heavy metal mute, was especially effective in detaching that sound from the rest of the voices.
It is heavy metal music.
Yeah.
So this practice, can you show us that practice mute? Where is this? Oh, you're just normal playing.
Go ahead.
Actually designed for apartment dwelling. So no, I'm serious. It's supposed to be for if you're to not disturb your neighbors, because we don't. It's very unusual to actually have that scored in a piece of music, but you see it has that sort of tinny quality that again sounds almost like a guitar stop or something like that. Yeah. So yes. Yeah, she didn't consult with us at all on this session. So the question was, she's being a reed player, does she need to know the cello really well and that kind of thing? So
I know everything about the cello except how to play it. I've done a lot of research. I've played a lot of chamber music with cellists. I ask lots and lots of questions over the years. I notice things. like the heavy metal practice mute. I had played in a piece that called for it, and I thought it was a really wonderful sound. In terms of a lot of the nitpicky details, I definitely have my orchestration book to make sure I'm not writing impossible harmonics and things like that. So there was definitely a lot of studying up to make sure that I did not write anything that was hopefully impossible.
Yeah, I would definitely say, wouldn't you, that it's very well written for cello. It lies well, and it's quite playable. And there's nothing, yeah, very colorful too. So you did a wonderful job of exploring this. Okay, all right. yes, another question.
I'm just curious, since you play lots of music by composers who are not alive, mm-hmm. what's it like for you as musicians to play for a musician who's not only alive but present in the audience? Is that a different feeling for you?
Yeah, it is a good question. So the question is, what's it like playing for an actual living composer who's there in the room as opposed to the dead Europeans we did before that? So with the dead Europeans, we can do whatever the heck we want and they won't say anything. So. I love bringing new works into the world. It's an exciting prospect. There's nothing like getting a score and opening it for the first time. I used to open the score, now I open a PDF, but and looking at the score and sort of hearing it in my head a little bit and imagining what it's going to sound like, and then it's a thrill to actually start bringing it into reality, and I think we really achieved, I think, pretty much what it was supposed to be, and it's a great feeling. And of course, she was at both of our longer rehearsals, we would say, well, is this the texture you're looking for, and what's the purpose of this particular thing, so I wish I had Beethoven around. Why the heck did you write forte piano there? We just have to imagine and try to make it work, and now we can. And actually, there's also some interplay too. Sometimes we can influence the composer a little bit. Like there were a couple of things in there where we said, "Well, maybe we could do it this way." And it's like, "Yeah," and it makes you realize, there's a sort of ethic in today's classical music world where we're trying to do exactly what the composer asked for. But then when you actually talk to composers, they're like, "Just make it sound good." I'll tell you just a brief story about that. Dvorak's New World Symphony, one of the most famous and well-loved symphonies. The second movement, the slow movement, he marked adagio, and it's a big brass chorale. It's a chorale, as it happens. And he marked it andante, which is a walking tempo. And then when it was premiered by the New York Philharmonic, right around the time when the Papa was written, actually, the conductor of the New York Philharmonic actually took a much slower tempo. And Dvorak said, "Oh gosh, that really wasn't what I had in mind, but gee, I quite liked it." Now it's marked adagio. So there's that interplay where you actually can influence. And in my experience, although I must say Angelique did a really good job of sort of getting the right tempos with her metronome, but a lot of times composers hear it faster in their head than the actual metronome. They put the metronome and the metronome marking often ends up being too fast to actually play in real life, and so you have to slow it down, but she did a great job of that. Did you have perfect click? All right, I think in a moment we'll break for intermission. I do want to mention a couple of things. For one thing, we are having, as you know, this is the final sort of traditional, with all the traditional trappings of simple measures, and a lot of people mentioned to me on Friday how sad they are and say, well, we're not going away, we're just changing the things and doing a little bit more innovative business model. So please do, if we do not have your email address, please do sign up near the exit, because we will not be sending out postcards and things. We're going to do it all online. All of our advertising is going to be online now. And we will be, the plan is to live stream and things like that. But do sign up for our email list. We're also having a reception, this being the final regular one. There'll be a reception right afterwards, and we hope you'll all come mill about and talk to us and ask us all the questions that you didn't ask, because the whole world is watching or whatever. And I'd also like to call Don Elwell up to the stage if I could. Don, are you listening at all? Don Elwell, please. Please come join us. Don Elwell. She is the person who's been behind the scenes for the last 5 years. And several months ago, almost close to a year ago now, she told us that she was going to become an elementary school teacher.
Yay!
And so she's actually leaving us next month, and I wanted to give her a special recognition and thank you for 5 years of tremendous work. Thank you. I have here a gift certificate for you to take people off to that fun place, Wolf something or other. It's a resort for kids and adults with the water park and everything. So,
have
fun. And lastly, before we break, I just do want to mention that we are continuing and changing the format, looking for a leaner business model. We will be presenting concerts that are free to the public, and they will be sponsored by house concerts, paid house concerts, and that's the current business model. If anyone is interested in information about that, we will be putting some information up on our website later, but you can certainly talk to me as well. And I would also like to take a special moment to thank one of our single largest and most important donor. And its donor is a small amount of what these individuals have done. They've been a huge support through the entire 10 years. They were there right at the beginning, and they have had concerts in their house, fundraisers for us, and just been a tremendous support, and they're continuing to support us as we change the model. So thank you very much, James, and Sherry Ray is back.
The pleasure has been and will continue to be all ours.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let's have some cookies.
Thank you.
want to mention really briefly that I kind of got it wrong. The cookies are for the reception afterwards, but there's the town hall has a what do you call it, concession place over here with things for intermission. So sorry about that. I misspoke. So there'll be lots of cookies after the show.
Thank you.
was a piece originally, come on up here. That was a piece originally for viola, da gamba, and harpsichord, but we're playing it tonight on cello and piano. And of course, Byron is well known as a specialist in earlier music, classical, a little bit of early romantic, and lots of Baroque and that kind of thing. And you have your own series too, right? Tell us a little bit about that.
My series is called Byron Schenkman and Friends. It's a Baroque and classical chamber music series at Benaroya Hall. I think there's some flyers over there somewhere for it. We've been doing 5 programs a year, some Baroque programs with harpsichord and classical programs with piano, variety of chamber music.
So originally when I contacted you, I assumed we would be doing this piece with harpsichord, but when we had our first discussion about it, you said you wanted to play it on piano instead. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, for both of these pieces by Bach, it made more sense to me to use the piano. I've played the Bach Gamba Sonatas many times, both on harpsichord and on piano, and with cellists, with violists, and with viola da gamba players. And I always feel like actually the balance is easier with cello or viola. The balance is easier with piano than with harpsichord. The way those pieces are written, they're 3 equal parts, the cello part, the right hand, and the left hand. And I think it's easier to hear the interplay of the 3 voices with these 2 instruments. And then the Brandenburg Concerto with these modern string instruments playing in a sort of a modern symphonic kind of a style. I think the harpsichord ends up just being kind of like a tinkly sound effect. The piano can actually kind of be part of the ensemble.
No, it's very true, because we do have a very different style. If you check out Byron's series, you'll see people who have specialized for many, many years in playing the early music, and it's a completely different style, and it's largely the reason it's a different style is because the instruments are really completely different. Even though you use cellos, they're set up in a early style, which means a lower bridge and gut strings and a different bow that doesn't have the ability to sustain to the end of the bow stroke as we do with these modern French bows. Modern means 1800.
That's modern to me.
Exactly. So it makes a lot of sense to play it on the piano. So do check out his series, pick up a brochure.
It's a great series.
And I hear it's a great series.
According to experts say.
I actually played on your series once, too.
That's right.
Or maybe it was before it was what it was.
Yeah.
But anyway, you played it. Yes,
I have a question for Byron.
Yes.
A lot of the early Baroque music, I do in this country dancing, and a lot of the Purcell, they wrote for, or they were adapted to dance. And I'm wondering if a lot of the early music wasn't more danceable than some of the more recently composed music. What's your opinion?
It's a really good question. He's asking about the relation between early music and dance, and talking specifically, he's talking about English country dances and the music of Henry Purcell, which Purcell made settings of traditional tunes. And there are also tunes by Purcell that became traditional tunes because they were really popular in the late 17th century and they got into the traditional repertoire. And the relation to dance is really key to the performance of Baroque music, especially, as Rajan was saying, playing on period instruments with the bows. It's very much influenced by dance rhythms. Baroque music comes from 2 places. One is vocal music and the other is dance music. It's all either trying to say words or trying to imitate the dance, or in a lot of cases, both.
Byron is very nice to be changing his style to suit the modern approach of this ensemble. It's a lot easier than us all changing our style to match you. The majority rules, I guess. All right, so this next little piece, it's a Brandenburg Concerto by Bach. And the piece we just played, by the way, was the Bach's Gamba Sonata for originally for viola da gamba and viola. I'm sorry, and harpsichord. And now the Brandenburg Concerto, which was written for a patron and wasn't played for a long time, is set in a closet. So it's nice that it's out in the open now. Thank you.
Thank you.